Well, welcome to this session. I guess that those words were maybe too much of many things. But this kind of company like UBM is, the size doesn't matter, the history doesn't matter, but what matters is that are we having capabilities to change? Are we having willingness to change? Are we having the right people to change? Are we having the culture to change? Our transformation has been pretty different to many other big companies, but at the same time we have had huge opportunities to change, and it's a combination of people, it's a combination of capabilities and beliefs, what can we do and what are the kind of drivers for change. I have a lot of slides, I will try to be brief, give room for kind of interaction and discussion. Like I said, that we are a big platform for entrepreneurs, and we have plentiful of kind of things that has happened and grown to businesses that we don't own anymore. We are having a lot of innovations today that will actually provide opportunities for small, medium-sized companies. But where we are good is always kind of horse-sized business. So when we are starting to put a lot of money on innovation, where we think that would actually give us an opportunity to grow, those are kind of target to have a billion sales, not tens of millions of sales. But at the same time, our platform is giving that kind of growth platform as well. And here I was stating, you know, whether these are questions or kind of statements of what are relevant questions, you know. When, like UBM was all the way through, we were a paper company. Producing paper. We are still a big paper company, but the change is now quite tangible. How we change, and we have not been kind of radically changing our position by just, you know, giving up on paper and then doing something else. We are not like 90s Nokia from rubber boots and from tires to just making mobile phones. Our track has been different and will be different, and is but targeting the same thing. What is our future? What we can provide for our shareholders and our people. Does reality hit you? That's a kind of question that, you know, when the change starts to be visible, are you ready for that change? Are you accepting the change? Or are you just neglecting and trying to keep and just keep where you are? Do you see opportunities? And how do you see the opportunities? What do you believe on? Are the company or the organization or people having the capabilities of utilizing those opportunities? And I will actually briefly tell you about what we are today, what we do today, and then finally talking about leadership values and maybe some of the experiences that I have had in my during my career. Like it was presented, I have been working for UBM pretty long time. But my positive opportunity has been that I have been working in almost every business area, in all kind of things. And I have had the kind of opportunity always be part of the change, be part of the something new. Whether it was when 1980s, you know, company was building new paper machines like two in every year, that was a huge time for a new engineer coming to the business. Chinese are talking about when the crisis is described. In Chinese language, they definitely have a kind of a bit different way of looking at it as we Finns or Europeans or Western world. Wei Yi, threat and opportunity. And that is a kind of a philosophy that we have actually adopted that, you know, hey, yes, when it comes to publication paper demand, like newsprint demand, we pretty clearly realized that already after millennium that will change. Very few people in this world realized that as early as we did. Why? Because we did have capabilities, we did have the organizational capabilities and people to realize it. 2005 and 2006 actually was a big year for UPM transformation in many respects. First of all, we made a very challenging big decision in Finland or in Europe to close down one big unit of our paper making units. That was 2006, and from this picture you see that even on that time, one could say that the markets will help you. There has been ups and downs, and there has been a lot of technology coming into the media platform. So once again, there will be a kind of better markets growth again, and things are sold out. It didn't. And I think that we realized in 2006 that, hey, now it is changing. We were the first company to take a big initiative. When it came to actually society and even in the inside of the industry, analysis, you know, investors, they were still saying no, hey, you don't realize what is now going on. Pretty much it is easy to say today that we were right. Once again, that was all about people, that was all about the knowledge base, the kind of analysis that we made at that time. So that is a more or less when you realize that the change is needed, what you do with the change. How do you lead people to get a really good view? When you are looking on the left-hand side, you see pretty much of challenges that could challenge you as an industry utilizing raw materials, whereas the power shift of the economy is changing from the Western world to East. Where the climate change is challenging you, and especially electronic media. And then you can treat that as a kind of threat or an opportunity. And we do both. We of course, you know, realize that, hey, we need to change when it comes to our paper business. We need to really drive for good, you know, profitability, cost competitiveness, which is not that fancy words, but that we realized and that we started to do. But then on the other hand, we put a lot of initiative to find new things. This year, 2006, was a big year for us. We are known to be a company, or we were the company closing one big paper unit here in Finland, and that was a big news. It was a big news for political front, you know, Prime Minister, Finance Minister, all of them called me and said, that's wrong decision. Nobody realized that on that very year, we made a big decision to put a lot of emphasis on the pulp making, fiber front, you know, to really build in big scale a new era for our growth. But as importantly, in August 2006, we had a kind of discussion, what should we do to find new products, new innovation? Well, how do we boost our innovation process and how do we actually run the business for the future? In August 2006, we decided that we are now putting all the emphasis to find a way of utilizing a residual oil pulp process called crude tall oil to turn that to a biofuel. It took us tens of millions of money, and it took us 6-7 years before we were ready to invest. And then we made a big bold move 2012 to invest 170 million for a product that nobody has ever done in the world, i.e. using wood-based raw material, turning that to a high-quality biodiesel. And that's a kind of, you know, bold move. Do you have the guts to renew yourself and do things? Obviously, nobody knows how far that takes us. We believe that can take us to a billion business size. At the same time, we had a kind of lot of program going on in smart labeling. We were the first one to put a big scale smart labels, to put the chip and the label together. Where UPM, I don't know if many of you knows, we are big in labeling business. Obviously, still we didn't have a kind of all the way through all the knowledge to run that, you know, kind of ecosystem that efficiently. So finally we gave up. We are a owner of one actually smart label producer, still having 10-11% of the shares, because we knew that our capabilities, our kind of ecosystem was not ready for that. At the same time, we had plentiful of blue chip ideas. We had a sensible floor idea, that you have a chip and a wooden floor to really collect information what happens on top of the floor. But once again, it was not in our ecosystem. It was more or less, you know, kind of business that we knew that, hey, our knowledge, our capabilities were not, you know, good for that business. So we sold that for an entrepreneur who has been then growing the business. And there are plentiful of these kind of type of things that has not stayed in our ecosystem, but has been growing to a business. So we have used this kind of opportunity. And coming to what is core in UPM, it's knowledge of biomass. We know the biomass inside out. We know how to resource it, how to source it. We do have the access to biomass. Technology capabilities, if one company is having technology to utilize biomass, recyclable, renewable material, it is us. So we came back to our roots in a way in this transformation. Let's do things that we know best. And then we definitely had the industrial synergies around the world to utilize that platform. So basically in this transformation, we started with all kind of things and then came back to a core that we know. And it was all about leadership. How do we really get to the point where we know the best? So this is a more or less where the whole thing started. This is, by the way, now the biodiesel plant, first of its kind in the world, reducing CO2 emissions by 80%. And if you talk about microparticles, you know, hugely less than that of fossil oil based diesels. The quality is pretty much as good as any of the fossil based fuels. You can fill your machine or your car actually based on that. I will answer the questions later on. You know, some time with this. UPM, I'm not going to go in details. Many of you have reviewed before I came here. Well, we are a 10 billion company. We have 6 business areas where we put a lot of innovation in all of them. Typically, we talk about big businesses like totally new businesses. But I will actually take one small, very traditional business that we have in this portfolio, and it is our plywood business. We are one of the biggest plywood producers in Europe and globally. And what we have done in that business is quite interesting. We have innovated a product that is now leading product in the globe of making LNG tankers. When the energy value chain is having the LNG tankers, where the gas dome is actually based to store the LNG, liquid natural gas. That is insulated with plywood. Why? Because there is minus 273 degrees of Celsius. And plywood holds the strength properties, whereas steel and other materials doesn't. We made a deal, a three-year deal in Korea for worth of 150 million last year. Suddenly, innovation came to a very traditional material to actually to be sold for a new way of transporting energy. And you can imagine how proud our people are when they have found this kind of ways. And there are plenty of this kind of cases around UPM now happening. I will nominate many of them. I will come back to some of those. Today we have five businesses that are growing, and the only paper, ENA, Europe and North America, is the business that does not grow. But we actually run the business as being the best of the industry. I'm not bothering you of these financial figures. We are doing okay in all of these businesses. Some of doing extremely good result, like energy, 42 EBIT margin. Bio refining, which is our pulp business, our biofuels business, and our timber business, doing really good. Raflatac, which is the labeling business in the packaging ecosystem, is doing good result and getting back to the track. Plywood, based on many other actions, is doing excellent. Cash flow is good. You know, we are actually having a. This is a core of the transformation, that our cash flow provides us funds for innovations and new products and new capabilities and new era. I'm not going to details on this. This is pretty much how we run the business. To be able to transform the business, we have a short-term, medium-term, long-term targets. What is interesting is the new business portfolio, which is now purely around the ecosystem that we know best, i.e. based on biomaterials or biomass and the capabilities that we have. Biofuels being the first one where we had now the big commercialization of the technology. The whole technology was in-house designed. The machines, pumps and reactors we bought from the market, but the whole design was done by UPM, helped by the ecosystem of universities and other kind of R&D centers. Biochemicals is something that we are putting a lot of emphasis now, and that is not public. We have huge amount of leads what we can do in the future. There we have a big team of people considering what should we do and how should we actually utilize once again biomass for a typical chemicals that are performance chemicals that are produced based on oil or gas or any other fossil raw material. And then finally, where we have put it smaller actually as a business size globally, is the biocomposites, where we have quite many nice leads and already commercialized products. Plentiful of investments, plentiful of ideas. We are developing the company for the future globally as a kind of global platform to utilize the kind of situation. When I took over UPM 2004, on that particular year we made most probably 3 or 4 patents. Now we are doing 350 patents a year. Majority of them are biofuels, biochemicals, and biocomposites. Of course, we do still, you know, patents on our traditional businesses, like in plywood. Plywood, we have made plentiful patents as well. And even in paper, which is a kind of business that doesn't grow, we do a lot of innovation when it comes to raw material efficiency, recycling, how do we utilize the kind of energy, so energy efficiency. So basically considering what can we do to make paper, whether it's magazine paper, whether it's copy paper, or whether it's any other cheaper or more raw material efficient. We as a company has become the largest recycling raw material user in global paper making. We use more than 4 million tons or 3.5-4 million tons of recycled paper. So basically we are utilizing the whole value chain for that. Then the kind of core of the change and transformation is to keep the balance sheet so strong that whenever you have an idea, you can make your dream happen. 2012, if we wouldn't have had a strong balance sheet and the performance that would actually support us to make the investment of 160 million, we would not have done it, although we would have had a good idea. And there would have been very few companies in this country, at least, if not in this continent, that would have been taking that risk. Why? The petrochemical industry didn't have the knowledge of the biomass. And then other companies didn't have any other or better balance. So basically, therefore, it is important to understand that, you know, what is the basis of our change. 2003, where we were purely paper company. We had some resources, we had some energy production, we had pulp production, we had this and that, but purely run based on paper. Today, 45% end of the second quarter was coming from paper DNA. So at the same time when our paper has declined, we have been growing pretty fast in the remaining part of UPM, as you can see from this picture. Zero sum game when it comes to sales, 9.9 billion. This is a busy picture, but telling that, you know, how much we have done actually to transform and to talk about what are the capabilities and the changes that we have done. 2008, we actually took a kind of then the brave step of saying that, hey, grow with Biofor. Biofor, first of all, was a kind of word that nobody knew what does it mean. And that was a great, you know, moment of life because everybody was asking, what do you mean by this word, Biofor? And, you know, hey, it was investors, it was media, it was even our own people asking Pirkko, myself, everybody, what do you mean by this? And that was a kind of name of and the kind of backline or kind of title for our change. And on that moment we realized that, hey, this starts to move on now. And then thereafter we have done a lot of things. I would like to now move to some of the leadership issues. I have been talking about the leadership as well. First of all, everything starts standing, you know, in front of the mirror and asking that, are you ready to change? And if I would have asked 2004 when I took over, what is the biggest hurdle of this company to be successful in the future? I would have stated clearly, readiness for change. We were not ready for change. We were just, you know, still sticking heavily on that what we knew best, making paper, making self-adhesive labels, making plywood, and that's what we think that was the right thing. And when I realized pretty on that very moment when I was nominated to be CEO that, hey, now the future is not going to be like the last 20 years. It has to be different. I was challenged in many of these debates why don't you innovate? That was a kind of first 2 years when the crisis started to be real for the paper industry
why don't you innovate? Why haven't you innovated?
And I was always asking that, hey, let's talk about the issue. And then I was always told that, hey, you need to take actions. I said, yeah, I understand that, you know, we need to take actions. Then many stated that, hey, 10 years ago, you should have been doing this and that and everything. And I said, yeah, pretty well, I might know it even better than you, what should have been done 10 years ago. And then when I was challenging the audience always that, hey, tell me what we should do now, that in 10 years time we are not sitting here and asking why didn't we do anything. Take action. Do something. And that was when I always said, okay, thank you. There we see how difficult it is to just, you know, start to innovate. And it takes guts to say that, hey, let's take this direction. And then you need to believe yourself. You need to believe on the business and the capabilities, knowledge and people, and let them to innovate. Like I said, that, you know, we made 3 patents in 2004. We are now making 350 serious patents every year. That is the cultural change that we have been able to do. And it is not because of me. It is because of the good people in UPM believing that, hey, we do have the capabilities of turning biomass to a efficient end product. Then, of course, then comes the other angle, which is leading people. And that is, for all of us, actually, the one of the most challenging tasks of the life. Consider how do I lead every one of my subordinates, and they are all different. One needs this kind of leadership. The other one is free to go. He knows exactly what he does. He's pretty actually clear what he needs. He doesn't need support. And then this and that. And that is a learning that we all need to have if you want to be an entrepreneur or creating a new business. I promise you. You are not going to do it yourself. You need to have a team. You need to have a people that you trust on. And then inspire, let them do things. And that's why one how we need to actually take that absolutely seriously. How we lead people. The direction, the belief, and then in a way that you let people to perform. And then finally, of course, in the business, especially the scale that we are, 10 billion company, you need to take care of the business. At the same time, we have had a huge challenge in declining markets in publication paper, but at the same time, we have been trying to boost our biodiesel people to really innovate and find a concept for making a biofuels technology and then finally a product or biochemicals or biocomposites. The only profitable platform gives you an opportunity to then grow. Values is something that we actually renewed as well. We started to consider what are the core values or UPM. There's a kind of universe of different values, and then it is all about what you think that are the values, most important values for the company that you run and for the people that you think that, you know, best can utilize the kind of value-based leadership. Achieving together is my favorite, to be honest. I've always thought that, you know, one builds an idea on top of the other's idea, and then it goes round and round. And finally, you're so convinced that this is the way that we want to go. Trust and be trusted is another way of managing the big business. Once again, we are 10 billion, 20,000 people operating in all over the world. So you need to just have a trust. Trusted people, those that are taking initiative and wanting to really run the business. And renew with courage. Today, if I would have been asked, or if I'm asked, what is the biggest hurdle of, of seeing the transformation of UPM, it would not be change readiness. Not at all, actually. I would say that the biggest hurdle is the kind of global economy and regulator. How much of regulation will slow down the processes that we are ready to run. Then talking about, you know, coming to a somewhat more personal issue. This is the slide from the UPM annual general meeting where there was 1,000 people participating. I just during the summer winter holiday broke my knee and really fell down, and my knee was totally broken. That period of time when I couldn't travel all over the world for 4 or 6 months was the best time of thinking. Typically CEOs are considered, I need to see customers, I need to see people, I need to be a president, I need to be this and that and everything. But that 6 months, I was generating a kind of thoughtful ideas, how do we go forward, and inspiring people by not moving at all, because I couldn't. I was coming with the car to the office and then from the office back home for 4 months, and then I took first trip to Poland, actually, after that. Excellent kind of stopping to do what you typically do. Huge drive, you know, do this and do that. See, you know, customers are so important. They are. But as well is the organization and the kind of leadership. And that I presented in the annual general meeting and said that now this is a bit kind of different moment of having a kind of incident that I was actually getting in my freedom. Then, are you ready to change? Are you ready to take the kind of feedback? Are you ready to challenge? This is actually a feedback of 2005 meeting that we held internally. Where I was pretty actually downbeat. I didn't smile at all on that very, you know, big meeting of 2 days. I was just, you know, telling only that, hey, now there's a need for change. And if you are looking what the people were saying, management is painting things black. Is he serious or is he ill actually? Is he sick? No new energizing guidelines, new ideas. Where is the revolution message? Cost cutting should not be the only theme of the change. But of course there were some positive comments as well. But that was the moment that I wanted to kind of convey the message. There's a need for change. But people were still, you know, I'm always telling the story that 50% of the 150 people were more or less saying, hey, he's not serious, he, you know, let's wait another 2 weeks and then he's back. 25% of them said, maybe he was right. 25% of that 150 people were saying, this is pretty correct, we need to take action. And that's a tough moment. I have to say that, you know, to get the feedback of like this was a tough moment of being 1 year CEO in UPM, having a long, long history being in inside of the company, and then getting this kind of feedback. But that was the moment, I think, that the corporate culture started to change. And if you want to be an entrepreneur, you want to be working for the big companies, it's similar. You know, you need to have people that you trust, you need to have people that you can challenge, you need to have people that challenges you. By yourself, I doubt that, you know, big things will happen in the future. Renew with courage, this is maybe now repeating myself already. I think that this was a great idea. We didn't talk about it. We decided in August 2006. We do have a crude tall oil, which was used somewhat of the crude tall oil was used for some smaller chemical companies to turn that to a kind of low added value products. And then maturity was burned to the energy. And we thought that, hey, this is great, you know, now we need to find for that product to be turned to a biodiesel. And now you can fill your cars in Finland already based on the UPM biodiesel. Suddenly, biomass company, paper company is producing high quality biodiesel. But this would not have been possible without really taking care of the balance, taking care of the profitability of the company, and at the same time letting people to innovate and find new things. And then finally, what we have done actually to really challenge our minds, but also the minds outside of the industry, was that we were making together with one of the Helsinki Metropolitan University Applied Science, the Bio4 concept car. Where, by the way, we were able to get a place for Geneve car exhibition between Mercedes and BMW. Think about it. You know, this car was on that place, and we did have a queue of car manufacturers looking this car and how that has been done together. The designer is a young 23-year-old guy of this car, and then when a group of people came from Ferrari stand and asking who has been designing this car, the guy, like a Finn, goes, you know, backstage and said, no, we don't know anybody here. And then finally, this guy was presented and you know, introduced to the Ferrari stage where they had their cars. The interest was so high, and I will show you a concept car video now before we are having time for the discussion. But this is more or less to challenge our minds and hearts. What can we do with the, if we have guts to do and transform this industry? And now I need to actually be help with somebody. This is,
yeah.
Interesting.
Look close. This is the modern car plant, a force of opportunities for a new generation of cars and a new way of thinking. Introducing the Bio4 concept car, a car where traditional oil-based materials are replaced with advanced sustainable biomaterials. A new generation of talent from Helsinki Metropolitan University of Applied Sciences applied innovative thinking, futuristic design, and bold engineering to create a car that challenges conventions. Using next generation biomaterials from UPM to replace traditionally oil-based materials. Biomaterials that combine sustainability and high performance without compromising quality or safety. Take a look at sustainability. Majority of the car parts can later be recycled and reused. And the car itself weighs approximately 150 kilograms less than a car of the same size. Take a look inside. Doors, enclosures, and many other parts traditionally made of plastic are made of UPM Formi biocomposite and UPM Grata thermoformable wood material. Moreover, UPM Raffatex environmentally sound label materials are used in the interior and exterior design. Take a look into the fuel tank. We replace traditional diesel with UPM Bioverno, a wood-based renewable diesel which will reduce greenhouse gas emissions remarkably compared to fossil fuels. The Bio4 concept car, driving real, sustainable change.
and gentlemen, now I think that this was my presentation. Let's get into the debate.
So, Petri, would you like to come and moderate Q&A?
No, we can take questions from the audience first, and then I'll ask a couple of questions.
Yeah.
So, anybody?
Yes.
So, you told about this biodiesel. And right now the situation is the price of fossil fuel is going down and down. So how do you see that, at what point your biodiesel is more needed or less needed? So where does this price of fuel to be so that it's
people typically ask this, and especially, you know, some of the investors are asking that what is the break-even oil price that you make profits. But our raw material cost is not based on oil. It's crude tall oil, and the price of our product is regulated by the regulator, saying that in Finland 20% of the transportation fuel needs to be biocomposted. So we are suddenly in the market where there's a regulator saying that in Europe 10% and in Finland 20%, and now there's a discussion that it needs to be more than 20% of biocomposite. So we are having our own market. And then when it comes to raw material, we are not in the oil price raw material. So basically, less than people thinks that oil price is relevant to our profitability.
And can it be used? Can this biodiesel be used in aviation to fuel the aircraft, like Boeing jet or Airbus jet?
Yeah, that is the kind of what we know already, because so we know there will be not only biodiesel coming from the process, but also fuel benzene, and that can be turned to a aviation fuel as well. So we have not gone that way yet. This was all started this January. So basically, that is the option for us for the future. That is absolutely great option, but not at this stage.
And you talked about this plywood for LNG.
Yes.
So do you license this process to some Asian manufacturers, or do you make it yourself and just sell the product?
We make it self. Of course, there are a lot of regulators that are putting, you know, standards for the what should be the strength properties and properties of the plywood. So far, so good. We are pretty good at it at this point and having a big share of the market at this point. We don't license our technology to anybody at this point.
This technology or any technology?
Some of the technologies, yes, we license, but, you know, less and less. We are typically, like I said, that we have been selling those smaller ideas to a entrepreneur or smaller companies to them, and then actually turn that to a business. But most probably, I will say that, you know, most probably we are starting to license our patents more and more. Obviously, that is a kind of area where we have been putting a lot of emphasis to develop those patents and technologies. And of course we are going to utilize those you know, portfolio that we have.
I think you had the new ventures program or unit in UPM before. Do you still have that, or which kind of measures do you have for increasing entrepreneurship inside the company?
We call it new business development department that we have. Which is in our technology, how do you call it, you know, function. And we are really putting a lot of emphasis, like I said, biochemicals, biocomposites, biodiesel, all kind of ideas that are on the heart and core of UPM, i.e. utilizing biomass. Lot of actions, you know, and a lot of new ideas. One product that we have not even discussed today is our Profi terrace material. The idea, most probably you don't know, the idea was recycled. We did have a waste coming from labels, because we are the second largest self-adhesive label manufacturer in the world. The release liner that we have actually back on the label cannot be reused. It has been always burned. And, so, and suddenly our guys had the kind of idea that we can recycle it to a kind of wood plastic composite. So we are utilizing a huge amount of material that was before burned, as say making, you know, now the terrace building there.
Go ahead.
So we have a lot of, you know, in this is something very difficult. I don't should I go this side?
Please, lady in the front. No lady?
As I understood, you told that at the beginning very few people were ready for change and wanted to change. Was there some turning point after which majority of people decided to participate?
Difficult to answer the question. I guess that we would not have been successful without having a kind of in the hearts and minds of people that hey, we are still ready. Maybe their behavior was not clear and open to change. But when they started to see the change, they were more inspired and more, you know, kind of willingness. It gave. I think that in the minds and hearts, everybody was willing to actually participate on change. Of course, some people left the company for a reason or another. But still, I believe that it was inside, but we were not able to pull it up to the surface. Yeah.
I have kind of like a follow-up question on that. So how did you manage to pull the change out of people?
I guess that there's no answer. Maybe I'm the wrong person to answer that. How I did it and how I was able to actually manage the change. It was putting myself in the position that hey, I will challenge you and you can challenge me. To be present, to be supporting the change. Now I guess that you know maybe my part of the change in the utilizing crude tall oil was just saying go for it. And we will provide you funds to actually develop the technology. But difficult to say that how did I manage it? It has to be asked from somebody else. You know, it's you cannot tell that yourself.
These ladies first.
Oh, thank you. Well, first of all, I'm so happy that you took the step to be part of Lonsosh this year. And secondly, that my question is that you probably hear this often, but where would you like the industry to be like 30 years or so, or where would you wish it to be?
Now, first of all, I think that our future will be still on those core competencies that we have. Access to renewable recycled material, technologies, and then global business. So UPM is going to have a product portfolio which is based on that core competence. We know it best in this world. So, all kind of products that are based on biomass. Most probably there will be still, you know, a lot of pulp, different pulp, maybe paper, maybe many other products, biofuels, biochemicals, biocomposites. So where I think that UPM is best doing horse-sized businesses, you know, billion business, and then utilizing renewable recyclable material globally.
Alrighty, and then the guy in the back. Yes.
Well, a follow-up question to that one is like, is UPM going to give up the paper business? Or, and if it's, when will that happen? Because from a shareholder point of view, as you said, you are going to continue to do the things you do the best. What if the best is not like that area is not maybe enough money?
Now, paper business is when we are actually looking the cash out of the paper business, it is actually as profitable as many others. You know, it has been a great cash engine, providing year in year out 300 million free cash flow. and with that 300 million you can do plentiful of things. So after investments, after you know restructuring costs, we have been doing 300 million every year free cash flow. So basically that has been one of the really core success stories of the company, to have those funds, to have the balance sheet. We don't invest, we don't allocate more capital on it, but rather actually have a kind of solid performance on declining market. And I have nothing against. They are, the people are great actually. They are having even more challenging world than anybody else. But you know, like I said, 300 million year in, year out of free cash flow. So giving that's a kind of fuel to any other problem.
Now these guys be waiting forever. So.
Yep. Okay. So firstly, thank you very much for the presentation. Actually, I have a question. I understood biorefinery is a very hot topic nowadays in Finland. And do UPM have some like ongoing discussion, like some investments in Asia, like China, for the biorefinery business? And I remember I read some news like there's one Finnish company named Temponis did some investments in China like back to 5 or 6 years ago. It was not going quite well. And what's the biggest challenge for this investment?
I mean, we were actually part of that actually, of utilizing straw to make pulp out of straw with the new technology. The unfortunate thing was that the technology didn't work. In terms of the kind of technologies work, but to get the kind of profitability or kind of efficiency out of it was not there. There will be more, most probably Kempolis is still, you know, developing the technology and there will be a day that it will. But at that time it wasn't the case. But that was once again, you know, kind of idea where UPM was very, you know, kind of brave to go in to a kind of pretty far we went with Kempolis, but then we need to step down and say that hey, the time is not right.
All right, guys.
There will be a time.
Yeah,
as well.
I think what we're going to do. Jussi's promised to hang around for a little while after the talk to have any private discussions that you might want to have with him. Let's finish by having. I have plenty of questions in mind. Thanks for asking all of yours. A nasty or nice question. Nasty? Okay, nasty first. Now that's the nice one as well. I have here the Nokia Technologies business units, business performance.
Yeah.
They make 800 million in operating profit, which is 68%.
Yeah.
Their technology transfer business is enormously good.
Yeah.
This is Intel. They've invested since 1993 into 1,400 startups, exiting successfully 570. 285 of which have been initial public offerings, so listed on the stock exchange. Why on earth do you not make the IPR and patent business a big business for yourself? Why do you guard them? Why are you not Linux?
I guess that, you know, that is not even a nasty question. during this 10 years time, you know, I have got a lot of nasty questions, but this was not one. I guess that the time is not yet there. We are not there. We are just, like I said, that 2004 we made two patents. You know, our kind of technology portfolio is now all about, you know, getting mature in a way that there is something to utilize. And we have done plentiful of which we have not counted, you know, like I said, sensible floors or smart labels and so forth, which have been going out of the company. Obviously, we are not going to guard them. For some of the areas, yes, we are going to keep them as like the crude oil-based biodiesel.
Yeah.
Because we are the only one, you know, hey, welcome, you know, if there's somebody wanting to come there, they need to talk to us at least.
Right.
But obviously, no, we are not going to just, you know, guard them. But I believe that we are not mature enough with the portfolio that we could actually get, you know, maybe, you know, somebody who is running UPM in 20 years from now will tell the story.
Okay.
And I hope, by the way, that the story will be for for the future generations, exactly what you said.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, let me say something nasty. I think you're not brave enough. I think you are. 300 patents are there. Let me give you an example of following up on what the guy asked right there. If you spun off the car business,
yeah,
how much venture capital investment would the company get?
Absolutely, but I guess that, you know, we do have the experience. You know Zurigo.
Yes.
Who was to generate and you know, who was really the company that actually was founding it? It was a predecessor of UPM. But we couldn't monetize it.
Right.
So we need to keep some of the ideas as far that we can get, you know, a benefit out of it.
Okay.
And there are, I promise you, there are a lot of patents that, you know, in the portfolio that we are not going to utilize any ever. Therefore, there will be a day that we'll let them go.
Exactly. Yeah. So my point here is spin it off before it's profitable, so that it would attract venture capital, international venture capital, and create great growth opportunities for the people who are in the audience here.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, second question that is not as nasty, I guess, is what are the capabilities of the entrepreneurial people here that UPM is lacking or wants in its ecosystem, or something that doesn't have to be so that it's employed by you? But what are the kind of growth companies and what are their key capabilities that you guys are relying on?
Of course, I don't know these people.
Yeah, no, but what are you looking for?
No, like the kind of what we are doing in Slush now, that we are putting a lot of, you know, ideas to utilize Slush small companies to make, you know, kind of industrial internet, you know, capabilities to you. There's
okay.
Plenty full of ideas.
Industrial internet one?
Yeah.
Any more?
No, there are, you know, even in the, especially the chemical, you know, the chemical side, that we have plenty full of small companies, universities, R&D centers. Unfortunately, I have to say that it is not here in Helsinki. The biochemical is more in our German front there, where the big chemical companies are there. We have a lot of, you know, people.
Oh,
yeah, sure. But, you know, it's that kind of things.
Okay, so I think, honestly, the purpose of inviting people over here from industrial companies is also to gain access and to create an understanding how many opportunities there are. You guys need to work hard to make these people realize what's in it for them. These big people need to work hard to get into the large and exciting businesses that transforming big industrial corporations are giving. I think it's a wonderful opportunity, and as I said before in the TLT talks, consumer business and internet marketing will not be as fruitful as an area for venturing as it has been for the past 10 years. Look into the deep value chains where B2B companies are dominant if you want to grow rich. Thanks very much. And another thing, let's thank Jussi again for battling the bad microphone. Good job.